Simon, you had a wonderful association with the great desert orchid, and you both won the first ever running of what is now the Matchbook Clarence House Chase 30 years ago.
Yeah, it was great fun. It was probably my most unamusing race I ever had with desert orchids. We've been trying to make desert orchid into more of a 3 miler than a 2 miler. And then Elsie, I think it was on the back of having just won a King George, and Elsie suddenly came up with this idea, said, look, you know, we can pick up this 2 mile along the way en route to going for the Gold Cup. And I said, oh, really, Elsie? You know, we've been trying to settle him and get him to jump more sensibly, because he always had that reputation of being a slightly overbrave jumper, and we were trying to get it a bit more economical. And Elsie just thought, no, you know, yes, we've got to give whatever it was, £28 to the rest of it. But
well, that's right. He says we can pick up this 2 miler.
Yeah.
But you've got Panto Prince in there. You've got Vocatini, who'd been third in your King George before. Yeah. You're giving them £22 and £23. Yeah. It wasn't a case of just popping round and picking up the prize money.
No.
It was a tough race.
Yeah, and they were hardened 2 milers on ground. That was probably, well, especially over 2 miles around here, when we probably wanted 2 miles. If we were going to go 2 miles, we wanted on heavy ground just to extend the stamina a bit. But Panto Prince was a renowned good ground horse. Vocatini had pace, quirky but pace, and very talented. And so Elsie said, yeah, no, I think we can pick this along the way. It'll be a good blowout en route, and it'll just sharpen him up. And
was he always like that? Was he always just very confident about wherever he sent the horse? Because he always seemed to be with his first couple of King Georges.
Yeah, Elsie was always just sort of, it was very much on the cuff. It was sort of very much ad hoc sort of decisions. And but he was the most, I felt, as a person to ride for, most naturally sort of came from the gut sort of type trainer. You know, no medical sort of scoping or blood tests or anything like that. It was all, you know, the horse is fine, we go. And when you look back on Desert Orchid's record, you know, it was always 8 races every season. Started as a 3-year-old, finished as a 13-year-old, whatever. And so there was no sort of some mothballs with him. So yeah, so the 2 mile at Ascot, that was the target, you know, with all this weight, and we had to suddenly wake the old boy up again and sort of say, right, you know, all full, but you know, get the sort of the Bunsen burner out and off we go.
And I feel that particularly Panto Prince connection, everybody knew how you rode Desert Orchid, and it was catch me if you can, if you could get away with doing it like that. And I wonder if he just felt, right, we're getting a load of weight off you. Yeah. And you've just won over 3, right. So I'll keep you up to your work on the front end. And if I'm in front turning in, and you're giving all that weight away, you've got to back yourself to catch me. But you did. You got back up.
Well, Brendan, without doubt, definitely had the remit that he was going to sit straight upside us from the outset and not let us sort of control the race from the front. And because Desi had got to the stage where he was becoming a little bit more cautious and clever over his jumping, Panto Prince was, you know, gaining half a length every time he got away from the fence. And so we were coming up together, and Panto had made another half a length, which is quite demoralising for a horse at the best of times. So the whole time we were having to press questions, ask the whole time, and you knew if you got one wrong, you were going to be out of it. And so it was a fight, yeah, from start to finish, which was horrendous. You know, I'd been very spoiled in Desert Orchid, I think, and in any times I ever had to push him or sit in him, it was probably from about 2 out at most. So, you know, it enabled you to cop your dock a bit and look quite stylish, and suddenly now, you know, from a mile out, one was having to say, come on, push.
Who was more tired at the end, you or him?
I don't think he was tired, because I think
was
actually
he not?
When you see him go past winning post, his ears flick straight away. I think it was more sort of thinking, crikey, we're actually going to get beaten, which I thought was just impossible to happen. And, you know, they were lugging into each other a bit, but it was, it was the first time I ever, I think I actually hit him once, it was the first time I ever hit him.
So. Well, there was a point around that time of people, I think, complimenting you and your style with him and saying, well, Simon never really picks up his stick with Desi, he never has to. But I suppose, was that by design, or was it just the fact that everything really up until then had been relatively easy for you on him?
I think I was listening to a programme yesterday with Frankie Dettori, and he was talking about Enable and how, you know, the communication is totally through your reins, and certain horses communicate better than others, and especially if they're honest. And, you know, with Desert Orchid, you got on him and you had such communication through your reins, and so you always knew what you had. And I think there was a day, yes, when he won the Whitbread here, carrying 12 stone 2, whatever, in a handicap. And people said, you know, weren't you worried when Kildimer, I think, came upside you? And I said, no, you know, we had a full tank. You know, you just knew you had a full tank there. And it was just a case of jumping a last and asking him a question and away he went. So he did, yeah, he communicated unbelievably through your reins, and you knew he was 100% honest, and you knew he was trained to the minute as well.